He was marred more than anyone was ever marred by men. That means when they were done with him, there is no way you could tell who he was. He completely lost recognition or any way to identify him. Why? Why couldn't he just take 39 stripes and some stakes in the hands and feet? Why couldn't he just shed his blood for the remission? Why did he have to get beat beyond description and lose his appearance? Because when sin got done with Adam in the garden, he didn't look anything like he was created to be. He lost his appearance, and the image got so perverted that he didn't look like Adam anymore. Because he didn't look like his father anymore. So Jesus lost his appearance to pay the price for you and me to get the identity back that we were created for. And he fulfilled what man failed so we could receive back what it was we were intended to be. Glory to his name. You get it?
Yes.
He did that for us. We have a hard time with inconvenience. We're on the way to church and get a call from somebody that tends to be burdensome. And why didn't they call 10 minutes ago when we went past their house? Now I'm 3 blocks from church and I got to go back 4 miles to pick them up and I'm inconvenienced. And I do it because it's the Christian thing, but I do it murmuring with disdain. And when they get in the car, I say, hey, come on. We were wrong the whole time. He was right the whole time. And he died as if he was wrong so we could stand and be found right. I am not going to be inconvenienced. I'm not going to complain. I'm not going to say he said, she said. I'm not going to deal with unforgiveness. I'm just not going to have it. Why? Because he forgave me of everything I've ever done. Amen. And he's made me clean. Who am I to forgive you of whatever you did when he forgave me of everything I did? Matthew 18 calls it an evil and wicked servant. Oh, he says they're a servant, but he says they're evil and wicked in their heart and intentions because they weren't forgiven of all their debt, but don't want to relieve men of their debt. They want to be recipients of mercy, but don't want to become merciful. And all of a sudden, they miss the whole point in self-centered deception. Whatever they get from God is so they become that in God. So men can see who he is through their lives. You get it? Can I be straight? We as the church shouldn't even wrestle with unforgiveness. It shouldn't even be a challenge if we truly understood we're completely forgiven. I asked the Lord, why do people struggle with unforgiveness? He said they don't accept and realize how free and forgiven they are, that I never see them for what they did. They see themselves for what they did. And because they identify through what they did, they keep doing what they did. But I don't see it at all. I see them through my son. And if they'd accept the true forgiveness and the liberty that comes through being clean in my presence, they would never be in unforgiveness towards a human being, because forgiveness is so powerful and it brings salvation. So if you're having struggles with anger and unforgiveness, you're probably getting your eyes off how forgiven you are. And self-righteousness can creep in, and deception and pride, and all of a sudden you're holding men to a standard that God never held you by. See, if you take the way you're thinking towards others and you can't translate it into God's mouth and make it work, then you ought to change how you're thinking. If you can't take your language and put it in Jesus' mouth and make it fit. You get it? I do those little analogies in my head all the time. Like, I'll picture Jesus just sitting on the Mount of Olives. Is it okay if I?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay. I didn't know if these were some kind of sanctified corner posts or something. I didn't know the heritage here. I thought I might be sitting on something holy. <I'm> sorry. I'm just having fun. It's okay to laugh in church and have fun. See, because you know why we do those little outbursts and laughs? Because it's laughing gas. It's like in the surgery, you don't know you're being cut. So you're like being cut and your heart's being, it's just totally circumcised and you don't even realize your chest's wide open. And you're like, hey, are you bleeding? That's what's happening. So the sillier we get, the sharper the knife that's coming. No, I'm just kidding. Could you picture Jesus sitting on the Mount of Olives? You know, he doesn't sleep much. It doesn't sound like in the Bible he's praying all night. He's just having a time. Could you see Jesus just hanging out, and Peter wakes up. And he's the first to wake up. And he crawls up out of his little thing. And he sees Jesus over there, and he says, whoa, I wonder what's wrong with the Lord. And Jesus just kind of sitting there bummed. Lord, what's the matter with you? You don't look like you usually do. Are you okay? Nah, I'm fine, Peter, just thinking. Thinking about what? Well, just the people. Look, don't press me, okay? I'm just working through some stuff. I need my space, and I really don't need you, Peter, in my face too much, okay? Certainly don't try to correct me or teach me, all right? I don't even know if you understand this. I'm trying to help people. I'm healing the sick. It just gets tiring, man. They keep criticizing, persecuting, condemning. I mean, God lets me hear their thoughts. I wish he didn't. They're pretty hard to handle. Like, you know, I'm over in Capernaum. They don't appreciate it. You know, these towns aren't repenting. I fed their belly. The whole reason they came across the water and found us is because they wanted another meal. They could care less about what I'm saying. And I just feel used, man. I feel unappreciated. I feel like I'm going to this extreme. I mean, you understand I'm God in the flesh, right? You said I was the Christ yourself. So you understand that I chose to become a man and come through the womb of a woman. Like, I demeaned myself so much. I sat in her belly for 9 months. In a bag of water. I sat in a bag of water like you. And I'm God. So it's just ridiculous. You think people would appreciate that after a while or think about it instead of criticizing it. I just don't know where I'm at right now. I'm in a little turmoil. I need my space. But I don't think I'm going out to face the masses today. I'm not in the mood. Doesn't that sound ludicrous to put that in Jesus' mouth? Could he ever even talk that way? We don't know him that way. But why is it okay when that's in our mouth? And we're made for his image. And as he is, so are we in this world, the representative of Christ. Why is it permissible? Because we're humans? Wonder if we're sons. Why aren't we convicted when we think that way? Because it's been our training? Because we were homeschooled in the wrong home? Wonder if we were trained by a lie. Wonder if we were born into Adam. Wonder if we were born into the fall of man and you must be born again. And that attitude right there isn't in the kingdom. And go preach saying the kingdom of God is here. Just take a look at my life. You see how nailed I have you all? There ain't no way out of this. You just have to say, I don't want this, or wow, I'll take this. I prayed a long time ago to the Lord. You don't realize how set up you are when you ask me to come. I prayed a long time ago to the Lord. I said, if you're going to let me have the honor of going to these places and people are going to sit in front of me and come back session after session and open their hearts and listen. I said, then you have to give me the ability to communicate that when I'm finished, a man only has two choices. He says, man, I hear what you're saying and I want that. Or I hear what you're saying, I just don't want it. But please, God, don't let him leave saying, what's he trying to say? But I don't ever get that. People, what's he trying to say? I don't ever get that. People don't say, man, you're confusing. You talk in circles. They say, dude, there's no way to not hear what you're saying. Kids understand what you're saying. My little granddaughter was 8 listening to Grandpa preach. And she leaned over to my wife, her Grammy, and she said, man, Grammy, my friends need to hear Grandpa. 8 years old. I told these guys I was in a service up north, preached for 3 hours and 6 minutes straight. You see how gentle I am with you? You don't even know how that's possible, but if you were in the room, it did seem like 40 minutes. And I looked at the clock and I freaked out. I said, what? I said, it was going on 11. 20 of 11. I said, is that the time? And everybody said, time? What? And then there was like this rumble in the room. Because nobody knew it was that time. I said, man, I got to stop. A 7-year-old girl leaped to her feet and said, no. Dramatically, no. Wow. I said, no. I said, honey, I've been preaching for hours. Man with a cell phone, 3 hours and 6 minutes. I got to record it. I said, thank you, sir. I said, honey, I've been preaching 3 hours and 6 minutes. How old are you? She said, I'm 7. I said, you're 7 years old. Leaping to your feet in distress saying no, and I preached 3 hours and 6 minutes. You should be pulling on your mom's arm saying, is this man ever going to stop so we can go home? She said, oh, no, sir. I get so much out of what you say. That's a 7-year-old. Don't tell me the people are leaving going, what's he trying to say? Nope. Wouldn't the love of God want to make it so accountable in your heart that you absolutely hear what's being said and you have to choose if you want it or don't, and that locates you? Wouldn't the love of God convict all men and give every man a chance to walk in truth? I prayed for that in my life a long time ago, and I feel like he's graciously given me that. I feel like I can get in a room of grade school kids. Well, I've done it. I preached all day in Christian schools and had a blast. And you watch kids cry because they're convicted, and Holy Spirit comes, and they understand. Isn't that fun? So you would never picture Jesus on that rock bummed out, would you? So I guess if we're following him, we should never be on that rock bummed out. So I guess if our motive is his motive and our perspective is his perspective and we allow who he is to be one with us, I bet that'll empower us to live different. And I bet if we keep studying and show ourselves approved and stay in prayer and stay in this place of exchange, I bet your grace will make us what our hearts are crying out to be. Would you agree?